Good morning, everyone. We having fun yet?
Oh, yeah.
Good. All right. Well, like Larry said, my name is Dan Darbandi, and I am the operations coordinator for the Midwestern Higher Education Compact. And I just want to start by thanking MEC for letting me give this presentation. It's the product of a lot of research into MEC's history using old agenda books, documents from the organization's past, and research help from Rob and Jennifer. So with that, let's take a look at some of the most significant achievements in MEC's history. It's going to be a look back at organizational growth, significant policy initiatives, and programmatic developments. So I just want to talk for a moment about how this presentation is organized. In looking at MEC's history, I kind of observed over the past 25 years, five distinct eras of about 5 years in length that showed MEC responding to specific challenges occurring in higher education at the time. So we'll go through each of those, but first I want to give a little bit of background into how MEC came together before 1991. So MEC technically was not the first attempt at a Midwestern educational compact. In the late 1970s and early 80s, the Midwestern Legislative Conference of the Council of State Governments proposed the Midwestern Educational Compact. Some of the driving forces behind that compact were rapidly increasing costs in education, declining enrollments, and an outflow of population from the Midwest. And at that time, eligible states included the current 12 MEC states, plus Kentucky, Oklahoma, and West Virginia. Unfortunately, that compact failed when only four states, those were Minnesota, Nebraska, Ohio, and South Dakota, adopted the compact statute, and five states were needed. So no discussion of the Midwestern Higher Education Compact would be complete without mention of the founding father of MEC, Dr. Philip Sorotkin. He was the, again, founding father and senior advisor of MEC. When he embarked on his quest to found MEC, the Midwest was the only section of the country that did not have a regional higher education compact at that time. Dr. Sorotkin served as the longtime executive director of the Western Interstate Commission for Higher Education, also known as WICHE, from 1976 through 89. And after working with state officials to found MEC in the 1990s, he served several years as a senior advisor to the commission. And we have a picture of him, as you see there on the screen, and he's on the far right side. So let's look at some of the states that joined MEC before 1991. First state to join us was Kansas on April 25th of 1990. A few facts about the state of Kansas' relationship with MEC. This past year, Kansas educational institutions participating in MEC Tech purchased over $4 million in technology hardware, software, and services. MEC's master property program insures over $13 billion in property values in Kansas, including all the institutions of the Kansas Board of Regents, Johnson County Community College, and institutions from the Kansas Association of Community College Trustees and the Kansas Independent College Association. The Kansas Board of Regents institutions were the inaugural participants in MEC's student health insurance solution, MEC Care, beginning with the 2012 to 2013 academic year, and we'll discuss MEC Care in further detail later on in the presentation. Kansas students and families have saved over $64 million in tuition through the Midwest Student Exchange Program to date, and again, we'll discuss the Midwest Student Exchange Program in further detail in a future slide. Let's see what else we have here. Kansas became the fourth state to become a member of the Midwestern State Authorization Reciprocity Agreement. And finally, through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Kansas developed the mechanism by which the persistence and graduation rate of service members can be tracked over time, as well as implemented a statewide website to provide useful post-secondary resources to service members and veterans. Joining us on the very next day was the state of Minnesota on April 26th of 1990. Now, many of you know that MEC headquarters are located in Minneapolis, Minnesota. This past year, Minnesota educational institutions participating in MEC Tech purchased over $21 million in technology, hardware, software, and services. Until recently, the MEC Property Insurance Program insured the University of Minnesota campuses with total property values of over $14 billion. Minnesota students and families have saved over $26 million in tuition through the Midwest Student Exchange Program to date. Minnesota became the sixth state to become a member of MSARA. And through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Minnesota developed the mechanism by which the persistence and graduation rate of service members can be tracked over time, in addition to having three or more state licensing boards that are willing to accept military training and experience as a way to accelerate progress toward earning a licensure or certificate. Third state to join us during this time was Missouri, where we are today, on May 9th of 1990. This past year, Missouri entities participating in MEC Tech purchased nearly $24 million in technology, hardware, software, and services. The MHEC Property Insurance Program insures all Missouri public four-year campuses with total property values of over $20 billion. Missouri students and families have saved over $35 million through our MSEP program. Missouri became the fifth state to become a member of the Midwestern State Authorization Reciprocity Agreement, and the state is an active participant in the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit. The fourth state to join us during this time was the state of Michigan on July 24th of 1990. This past year, Michigan educational entities participating in MHEC Tech purchased over $21 million in technology, hardware, software, and services through our MHEC contracts. Our MHEC Property Insurance Program insures institutions from the Michigan University Self-Insurance Corporation with total property values of over $8 billion. Michigan students and families have saved over $35 million in tuition through the Midwest Student Exchange Program. Michigan became the 10th state to become a member of the MSARA. Several Michigan institutions leverage MHEC Care, MHEC's health insurance solutions, which includes student health and the private health insurance exchange. And finally, through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Michigan has three or more state licensing boards that are willing to accept military training and experience as a way to accelerate progress toward earning a licensure or certificate, and implemented a state website to provide useful post-secondary resources to service members and veterans. Now, as I had mentioned, the history of MHEC is kind of divided into five different eras, and now we've arrived at the first part of those five eras, 1991 through 95, a time of policy initiatives and programmatic genesis. MHEC was officially established on April 10th of 1991 when the Ohio legislation, which was passed on January 9th of 1991, became effective, thereby becoming the fifth state to do so. And I pulled that logo you see there off of an early newsletter. Predates the one at the lower right-hand corner of the screen. The first commission meeting was held on March 10th of 1991. Early commission programmatic themes included student reciprocity, sharing technology, minority education, an information clearinghouse, avoidance of duplication, economic development, teacher reciprocity, governing, and last but not least, lifelong learning. So quite a bit from the very beginning. And of course, Dr. David Murphy, who's with us here today, was hired as the commission's first president on October 1st of 1991. Initially, the Council of State Government's Midwest office acted as MHEC's fiscal agent. After President Murphy was hired, MHEC was located at Central Michigan University, with Central Michigan acting as the fiscal agent. In 1993, MHEC moved its location to the University of Minnesota, with the University of Minnesota acting as the fiscal agent under an annual operating agreement. And I've got a couple graphics for you up there on the screen, and we see at the bottom a picture of the early MHEC office at the U of M, so we've come a ways since then. And at the top, I have a clipping from a MHEC newsletter circa 1991 discussing some of the final site selections for where MHEC might have been located. So, with that, take a look at some of the states joining MHEC during this period. Ohio joined us on January 9th of 1991. This past year, Ohio educational entities participating in MHEC Tech purchased over $12 million in technology, hardware, software, and services through our contracts. Ohio became the seventh state to become a member of the Midwestern State Authorization Reciprocity Agreement. One Ohio institution leverages MHEC Care. Through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Ohio has three or more state licensing boards that are willing to accept military training and experience as a way to accelerate progress toward earning a licensure or certificate, and implemented a statewide website to provide useful post-secondary resources to service members and veterans. And Ohio facilitates a statewide e-transcript initiative, which again, we will discuss in further detail in a later slide. Nebraska joined us on June 5th of 1991, and this past year, educational entities participating in MHEC Tech purchased over $3 million in technology, hardware, software, and services. The MHEC Property Insurance Program insures all of the University of Nebraska campuses and the entire Nebraska State College system with total property values of over $8 billion. Nebraska students and families have saved over $54 million in tuition through the Midwest Student Exchange Program. Nebraska became the third state to become a member of MSARA, and Nebraska is an active participant in the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit. Illinois joined us on August 20th of 1991. This past year, Illinois educational entities purchased over $70 million in technology, hardware, software, and services through our MHEC Tech contracts. The MHEC Property Insurance Program insures the Illinois Public Higher Education Cooperative Institutions, as well as Aurora University and Roosevelt University, with total property values of over $26 billion. Illinois students and families have saved over $87 million in tuition through the Midwest Student Exchange Program. Illinois became the ninth state to become a member of MSARA. Several Illinois institutions leverage MHEC Care, which includes student health and the private health insurance exchange. Through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Illinois implemented a statewide website to provide useful post-secondary resources to service members and veterans. And Illinois facilitates a statewide e-transcript initiative. And the fourth state to join us during this period was the great state of Wisconsin on April 18th of 1994. This past year, Wisconsin educational entities purchased over $21 million in technology, hardware, software, and services. Wisconsin became the 11th state to become a member of MSARA. Wisconsin students and families have saved over $28 million in tuition through the Midwest Student Exchange Program. Through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Wisconsin developed the mechanism by which the persistence and graduation rate of service members can be tracked over time and has three or more state licensing boards that are willing to accept military training and experience as a way to accelerate progress towards earning a licensure or certificate. Now, I just want to take you through a list of some of the programs and initiatives active during this period. We had the Minority Faculty Development Project, the Native American Science and Math Pathway Project, the Women in Higher Education Project, the Telecommunications Program, the Virtual Private Network, the Interactive Video Program, the Midwest Student Exchange Program, the Midwestern Higher Education Policy Workshop, the Risk Management Initiative, the Master Property Program, the Master Liability Program, Academic Course Scheduling Software, Academic Position Network, Regional Purchasing Initiative, the Midwestern Educational Technology Cooperative Project. So as you see, even in its earliest days, MHEC was involved in quite a bit of activity and was being ambitious from the very start. So as I had mentioned earlier, we're going to discuss the Midwest Student Exchange Program for just a moment. So it also is known as MSEP, and it was established in 1992. Public institutions enrolling students under the program agree to charge no more than 150% of the in-state resident tuition rate, while private institutions offer a 10% reduction on their tuition rates. MSEP participating institutions determine which of its programs will be made available to students from other participating states. Initial enrollment in the MSEP began in 1994. In the fall term, five states, which included Kansas, Michigan, Minnesota, Missouri, and Nebraska, participated. And at that time, 366 students enrolled. And currently, there are now nine states. Those include Illinois, Indiana, Kansas, Michigan, Minnesota, Missouri, Nebraska, North Dakota, and Wisconsin participating in MSEP with 10,132 students enrolled. The Master Property Program was established upon recommendation of MHEC's Risk Management Committee. It was designed to broaden property coverage, reduce program costs, and encourage improved asset protection strategies. It had an initial enrollment of 41 institutions with a combined total insurable value of $13.2 billion. And currently, the program enrolls 87 institutions covering 160 campuses, insuring a total insured value in excess of $91 billion. So that brings us to the second era of MHEC from 1996 through 2000. And this era, I noticed, was defined by expansion and experimentation of programs and initiatives, member state enrollment, and organizational structure. Let's take a look at some of the states that joined MHEC during this period. Indiana joined us on March 14th of 1996. This past year, Indiana entities purchased over $24 million in technology, hardware, software, and services through our MHEC Tech contracts. Indiana was the first state to become a member of the Midwestern State Authorization Reciprocity Agreement. Indiana students and families have saved over $5 million in tuition through the Midwest Student Exchange Program. Through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Indiana developed a mechanism by which the persistence and graduation rate of service members can be tracked over time, has three or more state licensing boards that are willing to accept military training and experience as a way to accelerate progress toward earning a licensure or certificate, and implemented a state website to provide useful post-secondary resources to service members and veterans. The state of North Dakota joined us on April 22nd of 1999. This past year, North Dakota educational institutions purchased over $2.8 million in tech hardware, software, and services. The North Dakota University System leverages MetCare, which includes student health and the private health insurance exchange. North Dakota was the second state to become a member of MSARA. North Dakota students and families have saved over $3 million in tuition through MSEP. And through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, North Dakota implemented a statewide website to provide useful post-secondary resources to service members and veterans. Now we'll take a look at some of the programs and initiatives active during 1996 to 2000, and we'll see a repeat of some of the programs and initiatives that had been active previously and those that continue through to this day. So we had the Academic Course Scheduling Program, the Interactive Video Program, the Telecommunications Program and the Midwest Telecommunications Alliance, the Risk Management Initiative, the Master Property Program, the Master Liability Program, the Midwest Student Exchange Program, the Interregional Cooperation in Student Exchange, the Midwestern Higher Education Policy Summit, the Minority Faculty Development Project, Academic Position Network, Midwestern Educational Technology Cooperative Project, the Regional Purchasing Initiative, the Natural Gas Initiative, the Interactive Courseware Initiative, the Regional Exchange of Courses and Programs, the Computing Resources Task Force, the Equipment Maintenance Management Initiative, MECTEC, the Distributed Learning Workshop, and the Army Access Online Proposal, and in addition, the Midwest Workforce Development Forum. So for an organization that was at most 9 years old during this period, again, we're involved in quite a lot of different programs and initiatives. MEC's Technologies Committee's charge is to leverage the combined volume of as many of the campuses in our member states as possible, and they do that by negotiating favorable agreements with technology vendors. A Telecommunications Committee was formed way back in 1991 to develop regional approaches to reducing costs while improving access and services. A Computing Resources Task Force was established in 1999 to engage in cost savings and related activities in the areas of computing hardware and software. In response to emerging technologies that blended both computer and telecommunication qualities together, MEC joined the above two groups in 2003 to form the MEC Information Technologies Committee. That initiative was called MECTEC. Currently, MECTEC has agreements in place covering hardware, software, and services, which are made available to higher education, school district, and state and local governments in the member states of MEC and our sister compacts, the Southern Regional Education Board, also known as SREB, and the Western Interstate Commission for Higher Education, also known as WICHE, and which produced over $286 million in sales this past year. So during this time, MEC took a look at some new collaborative approaches and ways to address issues facing higher education. The first of these was the Distributed Learning Workshop, also known as DLW. And in this, MEC established a new not-for-profit educational organization designed to promote more effective collaboration among colleges and universities for the aim of enhancing the pedagogical effectiveness of faculty, increasing the learning productivity of students, improving the interactivity and responsiveness of instructional settings, and promoting greater flexibility in the collegiate teaching and learning enterprise. In addition, during this period, MEC helped establish the Army University Access Online Proposal. So MEC's Distributed Learning Workshop partnered with several large corporate entities and educational institutions to develop a response to the Office of the Secretary of the Army, the Defense Supply Service, Washington's request for proposal in support of the Army University Access Online Program. Unfortunately, the MEC DLW proposal did not advance as a finalist. And I should also note that although the DLW separated entirely from MEC and has since ceased operations, these efforts further established MEC as a leading collaborative player in higher education, particularly as it related to distance learning. So now we've arrived at the third part of the five eras of MEC from 2001 to 2005, and in this period we see the pursuit of ambitious initiatives and robust revenue growth. Take a look quickly at some of the states joining MEC during this period. Iowa joined us on June 6th of 2005. This past year, Iowa educational entities purchased over $3 million in technology hardware, software, and services through our MECTEC contracts. Iowa was the eighth state to become a member of MSARA. The MEC Property Insurance Program insures the University of Northern Iowa with total property values of over $1.5 billion. One Iowa institution leverages MECCARE, and through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, Iowa developed a mechanism by which the persistence and graduation rate of service members can be tracked over time. So during this time period, we'll take a moment to consider MEC's presidential transitions. Put up a picture of our presidents there. We see that Dr. David Murphy was the first president of MHEC from 1991 through 2002. Following his departure, Dr. Bob Kustra served as MHEC's president from 2002 to 2003. After Dr. Kustra, Lana Oleen joined us in 2003 as interim president, at which time Larry Isaak served his first term as MHEC's president from 2003 to 2010. Lana rejoined us in 2010 to 2011 as interim president, and from 2011 to current, Larry has served his second term as MHEC's president. Now, as I'd mentioned, the third era of MHEC's history was defined largely by its ambition, and its independence from the University of Minnesota is among the ambitious highlights it experienced during this era. An operating agreement was signed with the University of Minnesota on November 5th of 1992. It was agreed at the time that the commission would pay the university 2% of its annual dues, which at that time were $8,120, and that allowed MHEC access to accounting systems, payroll, and other business services. The compact grew and required greater flexibility in terms of HR decisions, financial reporting, and payment processing. And the compact became fiscally independent from the university as a result of commission action on November 20th of 2002. Now, I thought this time period was a good moment to stop and look at how MHEC has evolved as an organization from a financial perspective. So back in 1995, the commission authorized MHEC to negotiate appropriate program service fees with vendors participating in MHEC initiatives as a means of helping MHEC recover costs associated with establishing and overseeing those initiatives. MHEC has diversified its revenue stream since the early 2000s, growing its program fees, interest income, and other revenues, thus enabling the organization to keep the state commitment as low as possible. From fiscal year 2003 to fiscal year 2017, state commitments, while growing from $82,500 to $115,000, represented a smaller portion of MHEC's total budget. So in fiscal year 2003, state commitments totaling $825,000 made up 67% of our organization's budget. Now in fiscal year 17, by contrast, state commitments, which currently total $1.38 million, represent 44.6% of MHEC's total revenue. So we've grown our revenue base during that time period. MHEC has established a healthy six-month operating reserve in addition to opportunity capital asset and future lease payment reserves. And finally, MHEC's state obligations remain the lowest of the four regional higher education compacts. So in an effort to avoid duplication of efforts and to leverage even larger numbers in the marketplace, MHEC began discussions with its sister compacts on expanding some of its initiatives to the entities in those compact member states. The concept was initially tested when MHEC entered into an agreement with the Western Interstate Commission for Higher Education in 2004 to make the Master Property Program available to qualified entities in the WICHE member states. MHEC now has agreements with the Western Interstate Commission for Higher Education for the Master Property Program, MHEC Tech, and MHEC Care. We also have agreements with the Southern Regional Education Board for the Master Property Program, MHEC Tech, and MHEC Care. And we have agreements with the New England Board of Higher Education for the Master Property Program and MHEC Care. Now we're going to take a look at some of the programs and initiatives active during this period. The Minority Faculty Development Project continues on. The Distributed Learning Workshop, which we discussed a little while ago. The Regional Advanced Placement Proposal. The Midwest Student Exchange Program. The Graduate Exchange of Midwest Minority Students. The Computing Resources Task Force. The Telecommunications Program and the American Tele-Ed Communications Alliance, MHEC Tech, the Regional Purchasing Initiative, the Policy Research, the Midwest Pearl, Office Supplies Program, the Workforce Development Forum, the Student Access Advisory Committee, the Risk Management Initiative, the Master Property Program, the Property and Casualty Package Program, the Umbrella Liability Insurance Program, the Equipment Maintenance Management Initiative, and finally, academic scheduling software. So following the commission's desire, MHEC strengthens its policy research emphasis as a complement to its existing programmatic focus. MHEC hired a policy analyst and research associate way back in 2003. MHEC began holding annual policy summits in conjunction with the commissioner meetings. It developed a policy research arm that prepares research briefs, notes, and papers, as well as answers inquiries from commissioners, legislators, and higher education leaders. And currently, MHEC has research available in areas such as state policy and performance evaluation, assessment of institutional effectiveness, and campus-based practices for promoting student success. Our current work is focused on college affordability. Now we'll take a look at the fourth of MHEC's five historical eras, and we'll see how MHEC continued to strengthen as an organization and look to expand its programs across international borders. States joining MHEC during this time: South Dakota on March 13th of 2008. This past year, South Dakota educational entities purchased over $1 million in technology, hardware, software, and services. Through the Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit, South Dakota developed a mechanism by which the persistence and graduation rate of service members can be tracked over time, as well as implemented a statewide website to provide useful post-secondary resources to service members and veterans. So the MHEC Commission in 2006 approved amending the bylaws to permit affiliate membership to those states and, interestingly, Canadian provinces not statutorily eligible to become a member state, and approved amending its bylaws to permit entities not eligible to become members of the compact to be afforded status as associates of the compact in accordance with commission policies. And although MHEC still does not have any affiliate members, MHEC has held serious discussions with other states and provinces about an affiliate status. Now, during this time, we unfortunately lost Dr. Sorokin, and I think it's important, again, to take a moment to consider his lasting legacy and the many contributions he provided in service of Midwestern higher education institutions and for students. And MHEC established the Philip L. Sorokin Award in 1999 to honor exemplary leadership service to the Midwestern Higher Education Compact in his name. Programs and initiatives active during this period: we had, of course, the Midwest Student Exchange Program, the E-Transcript Initiative, the Risk Management Initiative, the Master Property Program, the Property and Casualty Package Program, MHEC Tech, the Office Supplies Program, the Regional Purchasing Initiative, the Energy Risk Management Initiative, the American Tele-Ed Communications Alliance, the Student Access Advisory Committee, Policy Research, the Midwest Pearl, Education to Workforce Initiative, Difficult Dialogues Initiative, Credential Repository for Education Skills and Training, Closing the Gap Initiative, Pathways to College Network, the Energy Risk Management Initiative, MHEC Care Health Insurance Solutions, which we'll discuss in just a moment, the Employee Health Benefits Program. So, again, quite a wide range of initiatives and programs pursued for an organization that was overall not very old during the time. The E-Transcript Initiative was established in 2006 upon recommendation of the MHEC Student Access Advisory Committee. It offers a mechanism to facilitate the transfer of student information in a consistent format between MHEC's public and private high schools to MHEC's public and private colleges and universities. ETI also facilitates the transfer of student information among all participating MHEC post-secondary institutions. Four states, Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, and Ohio, currently manage statewide initiatives. MHEC Care started in 2010. It helps institutions support the student learning experience by providing protection from unexpected medical expenses. In 2008, the Lumina Foundation for Education awarded MHEC a grant to implement regional initiatives to improve higher education productivity for colleges and universities facing increasing costs in, among other areas, student healthcare costs. In 2010, MHEC entered into an agreement with an insurance carrier to provide student health benefits as part of MHEC's region-wide student health program called MHEC Care. A second carrier was added to MHEC Care in 2015. Also in 2015, a new private exchange product was added to MHEC Care that enables institutions that do not or are unable to offer an institution-sponsored student health plan an insurance option for their students. Currently, 32 institutions across the United States are participating in MHEC Care. All right, we've arrived at the final of MHEC's five historical eras from 2011 to present, a time where the organization has grown to the extent that it can take on large-scale grants and continue to build on its ambitious goals. In 2012, MHEC moved its office from the West Bank office building on the University of Minnesota campus to its new location seven blocks down the Mississippi River in the Crown Roller Mill building. Some of the programs and initiatives active during this time: the State Authorization Reciprocity Agreement, the Multi-State Military Credit Collaborative, the Higher Education Redesign Initiative, Tuning, Policy Research, Difficult Dialogues Initiative, which Kristen will be having with me if I don't wrap this up soon. Thank you. I'll be here till tomorrow. The Closing the Gap Initiative, the Credential Repository for Education, Skills, and Training, the Special Committee to Review Higher Learning Commission Policy on Faculty Qualifications, MetCare Health Insurance Solutions, the Employee Health Benefits Initiative, Pharmacy Benefits Management Program, the Energy Risk Management Program, MECTEC, the Risk Management Initiative, the Master Property Program, the E-Transcript Initiative, which you'll remember from a few slides ago, the Midwest Student Exchange Program. MEC, working in conjunction with the other regional higher education compacts, began implementing the State Authorization Reciprocity Agreement in 2013. It is a voluntary agreement among participating member states and U.S. territories that establishes comparable national standards for interstate offering of post-secondary distance education courses and programs. It is intended to make it easier for students to take online courses offered by post-secondary institutions based in another state. By August of this year, 11 of the MEC member states signed on to participate in MSARA. South Dakota is participating through the Western Interstate Commission for Higher Education, thus making the Midwest the first region to have all states on board for SARA. 42 states have joined SARA plus Washington, D.C. At the time of the writing of this presentation, there are 1,134 institutions participating in SARA, and 472 of those institutions are from MEC states, accounting for 42% of all SARA participation. The Multi-State Collaborative on Military Credit was established in 2014 upon award of a grant in the amount of $900,000 from the Lumina Foundation. The mission of MCMC is to facilitate an interstate partnership of the 12 MEC states plus Kentucky and translate competencies acquired by veterans through military training and experiences through college credentials leading to employment in the civilian workforce. MCMC exchanges information and shares best practices in the areas of articulation of academic credit, communication and outreach, data, technology and systems, and licensure and certification. And folks, that's the end of my presentation. I want to thank MEC for providing me with the opportunity to educate you about its history. It's been an honor, and I want to share my appreciation for each and every one of you involved in the organization serving our state students and institutions. So now that we've looked at what the record books have to say, I'd like to turn it over to our panel to get a firsthand account of what it was like to be a part through MEC, of MEC throughout the years. Thank you.
Great job. Great job, Dan. Thank you very much. Well, I learned a few things in there. I hope you did. It's been a robust organization for 25 years. Well, we've got people who were there in the beginning. That's not to make a biblical quote out of anything, right? We don't want to age you that much, right? In the beginning, we have four panelists who are going to help us. Let me introduce them. First of all, David Murphy, over there on the end. David was the first president of MEC and is MEC president emeritus. He came out of education in Minnesota and Illinois and Michigan, good Midwest roots. Spent most of his career in Michigan in various positions, both in higher education and with the state legislature, Senate, I think, most for part of it, and you know, on many regional, national panels and so forth. He retired in 2002, and his wife Betty is here today, and they live in Bloomington, right outside, or is it? Burnsville, yeah, Burnsville, which is a south suburb of Minneapolis-St. Paul. The first commission chair was Dr. William Sederburg, Bill. He grew up in Minnesota, so another Midwestern roots person, and got his PhD in political science from Michigan State. And then became a state senator along the way there, and he was elected to the State Board of Education first, and then he served 12 years as a Republican state senator. Was that before term limits?
Yes.
Before term limits. Distinguished himself as an advocate for higher education, and then he became very active in creating MEC, part of his kind of looking forward vision that really characterizes Bill's career. In 94, he became president of Ferris State University, and so we've had a Ferris State University leader involved with MEC for many years. Now we have our good friend Dave Eisler over here, who's president of Ferris State on the commission. And then He left Michigan. He left the Midwest for a while to become president of Utah Valley State College. In some ways, kind of another startup university. And so he became involved in that. He had so much success with that that the State Board of Higher Education in Utah, or the Board of Regents as it's called, asked him to serve as Utah Commissioner of Higher Education, which he did for a number of years. He's now retired in Asheville, North Carolina, but he does do some interim presidencies, and he's involved in a lot of things yet, believe me. Just wrote an article for the Chronicle last week, Chronicle of Higher Education. So Bill was our first chair, served 2 years as chair, but he traveled around. He'll talk about some of that. And then Lana Oleen was there in the beginning and then in the interim a couple of times. Lana was a commission chair from 2002 through 2004, and she also served as interim president a couple of times in 2003 and 2010-11. She was in the Kansas Senate for 16 years. She was majority leader of the Senate. Been very active in a number of national organizations, legislative organizations, military organizations, and many, many other things, state tribal relations committees, and so forth. So these four people are going to give you their perspectives. Lana lives in Manhattan, Kansas. Kansas State Jayhawks? No. Oh! I just wanted to make sure you were okay there. Everybody's awake, and I'm looking forward to this. So, Roger Moe. I have to turn one more page. My goodness. Roger Moe. I don't think there's too many people in this room who don't know Roger Moe. Believe me, Roger is another Midwestern roots, Minnesota roots. Did his undergraduate work at Mayville State University in North Dakota. Roger resides in western Minnesota. Roger has really distinguished himself in many ways in the political arena and outside of it in so many ways. He received an honorary Doctor of Laws degrees from the University of Minnesota for his public service in 2004. He was elected to the legislature in 1970. He was 13 years old at the time. Oh, yeah. 1970, Roger was elected. He served until January 2003, 33 years. He is still the longest serving Senate majority leader in the Minnesota State Senate, where he served as majority leader for 22 years. Not a lot of majority leaders get to stay that long. I think that tells you about his political abilities and his ability to work with all kinds of people. And I've observed it, and it's just incredible. He has been involved in many efforts. One of the major ones was in creating the Minnesota State College and University System, which I think now might be the largest system in the country of institutions as one system. And also he was involved, of course, in starting the commission. He was the chair of the Midwest Legislative Conference, okay? Oh, yeah, he was the chair of the Midwest Legislative Conference when the legislation was drafted. So we've asked these four people here today to reminisce and talk about what it was like when everything got going, but also, you know, what their perspective are on things here now 25 years later. So who are we starting with? You've decided among yourselves, I think, somehow here, right?
We decided our senior citizen.
All right. Senator Moe.
Thank you. First of all, thanks for the invitation to be with you. And secondly, congratulations on your 25th anniversary. From the previous presentation, you've just done an outstanding job. And those of you that are new to the commission, I know that you will build on that outstanding foundation that has been set. You acknowledged my former colleague, Representative Lyndon Carlson. during your introductions, I want you to know that we in Minnesota will also acknowledge him again on January 3rd of 2017 at noon on January 3rd when he's sworn in for his 45th consecutive year, and which will be a record in Minnesota. He will be the longest serving member of the Minnesota Legislature. So let me get to this, and I'll keep it brief. This organization today probably would not be here were it not for the Council of State Governments. I think the Council of State Midwest Conference of the Council of State Governments provided the kind of forum and catalyst for bringing this all together. And I have to acknowledge Mike McCabe, again, a great leader of the Midwest Conference. He has been the head of it since 94, but he was at the office back in the late 80s as well. So he's had a long history with the compact here. Obviously, experiences in our lives influence us and influence our decisions. And so I'm going to tell you a couple of stories about what had an influence on me about this and other things in higher education that I worked with. I was chair of the Senate Finance Committee in the late 70s. And at the time, Minnesota was looking at building a veterinary medicine hospital. And at the same time, Wisconsin was thinking of doing the same thing. And so I invited legislators from Wisconsin over to Minnesota, and I suggested that maybe we should just build one and then have, you know, a guaranteed number of slots in that vet medicine system. And we had a good discussion about it, and my guests from Wisconsin went back, and not long afterwards, obviously, the word came back that no, that was not, wasn't to be. You can imagine the agricultural politics of a state like Minnesota and Wisconsin. No, they had to have their own, and so that didn't work out. But obviously, that had an influence on my thinking about higher education. The other was, I apologize for, because you probably don't know the geography of Minnesota, but there's a little community up not far from where I live, Thief River Falls. And back at the same time in the late 70s, they wanted a new technical college or technical campus. And I said that was okay. I was chairing the finance committee, so I could help make that decision. And I said, but I want you to build that campus connected to the community college that was there. And so they did so. They community college, and they built the technical college right next to it with a commons area for students. Now let me go fast forward 10 years to the 80s. It didn't make any difference. My idea at that time was, I thought if the two campuses were together, you'd see some coordination. 10 years later, they both had their own administrative head. They both had their own student financial aid. Everything was duplicated. And so that had an influence on my thinking. Also during that time, during these CSG meetings that Mike and I would attend, and maybe some of you were involved with that back then, but if you recall, there was another recession back in the 80s, and it was a severe commodities, natural resource recession, ag, forestry, mining, those were hit particularly hard. And so states were wrestling with their budgets. And what did they do? The cuts in the various budgets, but I don't think any area was cut as significantly or reduced like higher education. So you had that taking place, and at the same time, increased pressure on corrections budgets and healthcare budgets, because those were ratcheting up quite quickly. And so higher education kept being squeezed and squeezed. And so I recall one meeting, it was the Executive Council of the Council of State Governments. We were sitting around, we were talking. Everybody kind of gave a recap of their states, and it was almost the same story from every state. And at that point, Mr. Sorotkin was also telling us about WICHE and that effort. And so 1989, I became chair of the Midwest Conference of the Council of State Governments. And back then, I'm not sure what it's like now, but back then, the chair could advance an initiative. And I thought that this was right in line with the times and the situations that we were facing in the various states. And as such, we moved ahead and passed the resolution. And the states, then there was this model legislation, and we raced very hard in Minnesota, Lynn and I. He was the House author, I was the Senate author. We passed it, and we wanted to be the first, but Lana preempted us by one day, and they passed the legislation one day before Minnesota did. And so the rest, as you know, is history. I'll now yield to Bill.
Okay, thank you, Roger. I'll pick up where he left. The group met in St. Paul, heard a great speech by Phil Sorotkin, and people got mobilized. And my state Senate leader, John Engler, was at that meeting. And I remember he came up to me right after the meeting and said, Bill, there's been this great idea proposed to create a Midwest Commission on Higher Education. You like higher education. Will you be interested? And he said, by the way, I have Roger Moe on the telephone. He wants to talk to you. So there was Roger Moe. Now, I respected Moe as a senior elder so much. I was a much younger state senator at the time that I was willing to do whatever Roger Moe had an interest in. But one theme that I want to stress is just that this organization and the people that have been involved in it are really delightful, fun people to know and are committed to the public good. And that's been a unifying theme throughout the entire 25 years. And that certainly started. So Phil Sorotkin was an energizer bunny that just loved public policy. He loved politicians. He loved stories. He was great for Roger, me, and others to connect with, and it was fun. So we had a meeting in Salt Lake City to draft the charter, and it had to be the same charter that would be approved in all the states, exactly the same language. Mike McCabe and others did a good job at presenting us a model charter that we could use. Some of the highlights of this charter I'd like to emphasize, because I think it's important for your ongoing work. One is the charter called for it to be a state organization, not a higher education institution organization. So no offense to the institutions represented here, but the Midwest Commission, right from the get-go, was to represent state government. Further was a coalition that the emphasis would be on the legislative branch, not the executive branch. And that was probably because Roger and I were in the legislative branch, and we knew that all the wisdom was there, and predominantly in the Senate, it turned out. But it we focused in on the legislative branch, and then also bipartisanship. Now, as we met in Salt Lake City, a couple themes developed. One is we needed to make it affordable for the states because they were going through a lot of difficult times. So we said, how much would the dues be? And we said, well, we need at least $300,000 to have any kind of organization to hire Murphy or do something. And we said, but that's six, if we need five states, 300,000. So that doesn't sound very scientific. So let's round it down to 58,000. So we came up with 58,000 because that sounded like we knew what we were doing. We just picked that number out of the air. So that was your initial dues structure. We also, at that time, wanted to make an emphasis on cost containment because that's what all the states were going through, and that tradition continued. So we put together the charter. We liked it. We then had the job of selling it throughout at least five states. Minnesota, those guys, and Kansas were falling all over themselves to be number one, so that was not an issue. My state, Michigan, was an issue because the institutions did not want MHEC. No offense, Dave Eisler, president of my good school, Ferris State, but I had to call, as chair of the Appropriations Committee, I had to call a couple of state presidents in, and the president, Dan Hurley, you're the president's counsel, new name now, but had to call in your predecessor and say, look, I'm chairing the Higher Ed Appropriations Committee. I'm on this. It's only $58,000. You get $2 billion. I want $58,000. and they saw the wisdom. And so they said, well, okay. But since then, I think there's been a change of heart, and people are kind of supportive of that out of Michigan. So we came up with five states, a lot of great lobbying. It was fun to run around and lobby, except for one trip, and that was Iowa. Do we have anybody from Iowa here? Iowa, bless you guys for joining finally. Dave Murphy and I got on a state plane. It was like minus 25 degrees. The wind was blowing. We froze in this stupid state plane. I mean, we were huddled up in the back of the plane going to Iowa. We landed there. We're going to meet Branstad, was still the governor then, and still is today. He was fine, but he said, you got to talk to the legislative leaders. Well, there was a big scandal that hit the night before. Some legislators got indicted for something or other, and that's only thing that people wanted to talk about was a scandal. So we never succeeded with Iowa, and it took like 12 years. So Iowa, thanks for finally joining the Midwest. But there's a lot of great Iowa stories. So we went around, we sold the idea, did lobbying. The highlight, since I have the microphone, I have no other group is interested in this topic, but you might be. The highlight of my life lobbying was in Nebraska. Do we have the Nebraska delegation? Randy Frilich, oh, right over here. Frilich has been here since Moses, I think. Frilich, Randy has been here a long time. I go to speak before the higher ed, the education committee in the Nebraska legislature, and I was born in Shadron, Nebraska. So you try and, you know, good political thing, you try and make some connections, you know, the Midwest. So I said I was born in Shadron, Nebraska, and my father ended up teaching at Nebraska Wesleyan in Lincoln. Well, it turned out Sandy Schofield, who was chairing the committee and one of our founders of MHEC, was also born in Shadron, Nebraska, 1 week apart from the date I was born, and we had the same family practitioner that delivered us. So we had an immediate rapport, and the budget director of the state was in 4-H with my sister in 1957. And the lobbyist for the Independent Colleges Association, his mother had my father as an advisee in 1949. So nobody moves from Nebraska, apparently. And Frilich, you're an example of that. So that was just one thing. But we got it through the legislature and got the five states established. Then the issue moved on to organizing, just a couple highlights of that. One was the selection of the president. We had a great pool of candidates. It boiled down to two candidates. We ended up selecting Dave Murphy, who did a phenomenal job. But the highlight of that interview, I don't know whether you were there or not, but I had talked the committee into interviewing a non-traditional candidate from one of our states who had been a very powerful politician and was a supporter of higher education. He was going to be the non-traditional candidate. Before the meeting starts, we had 2 hours of time blocked off for this candidate before we interviewed Murphy and another candidate. Before it even starts, we're just sitting there shooting the bull, and we asked the candidate, have you read any good books lately? And the guy says, oh, I haven't read a goddamn book for 10 years. He says, it's not useful. And the entire search committee turned to me and said, what do we do for 2 hours? You know, it just, That was a low point in the search process. So even Murphy looked good at that. He had read a book, and it was a fairly big book, and so we were impressed with that. Then we had the issue of so we hired Dave, and Dave will talk next and talk about that. But a couple other issues. We ended up in Minneapolis, but our first choice was Cleveland. I don't know if many know this, and Dan, I'd surprise your research, but we had a search process, and we went around, and we had states bidding on where we were going to be located, and states had really great proposals, you know, just kind of sweeten the pot a little bit, trying to entice the commission to their headquarters. We selected Cleveland and Cleveland State University, and so we're all fired to be located on Cleveland, and I think Kansas and Nebraska and another state, Missouri was it, said that Ohio was not in the Midwest, and certainly Cleveland. Cleveland was not in the Midwest. And so
we had the chair, Rick Bowden.
Oh, that's right, Rick. So anyway, we changed and ended up back in Minnesota, and we moved and set up the headquarters at the University of Minnesota. So that was a big issue. Then another issue that you should all thank, all of us at the table, you are indebted to us. we made a decision that the dues would incorporate the cost of travel and hotel bills for the commission members attending the meetings, because some of us that have been in politics knew that the public was watching any kind of travel. When a recession hit, many states were eliminating travel to commission meetings. So we made that decision that the organization would pick up your travel and hotel bills as well. So you're welcome. I think that was a good decision. And finally, and just to transition here, another fundamental decision that I'm really proud of that our group made was that we decided not to build a bureaucracy. You saw this list of initiatives and stuff, and it's mind-numbing. I mean, it just a lot of things going on. Well, we decided not to build up a bureaucracy, but rather to use a model of kind of asset-based strategies, where we looked around the Midwest and said, what are the assets of our institutions and our states? How do we get smart people together to meet cost containment needs? And we were able then to mobilize, under Dave's leadership, a number of initiatives without adding a lot of staff and a lot of the bureaucracy. And I think, frankly, that's a model of organization that is more and more in practice, but is going to be the structure of the future. And that is to not have large structures with lots of employees, but rather have program-based initiatives with ongoing coalitions and networks based upon the various needs of your membership at any one point in time. So with that, we were just excited to hire Dave Murphy. We got him out of Central Michigan University. Dave really set the program base to this organization and was able to get it on sound financial ground. So Dave, turn it over to you. And I know a lot of stories about Dave, but I'm being very pleasant, and I'm not going there today. But if you want, I can be glad to share some stories about Dave.
Thank you, Bill. Can you hear me? Okay, great. Well, I'll go back a little bit into the 1980s as well. Phil Sorotkin and I had been good friends for a number of years through the 1970s and the NGIMS national program efforts in zero-based budgeting and modeling and things like that. And in 1979, in fact, Phil wanted me to come with Wichi, his organization, to work with him. But we were right on the cusp of a major recession in Michigan in 1980, and I was working for the Senate Fiscal Agency at that time, and we were faced with some really overwhelming challenges in terms of how do you feed the masses with five loaves and five fishes. It was a really very, very difficult time, and I just didn't feel that I could leave. I'd also had the privilege of working under the leadership of Bill Sederburg, who was chair of the Senate Appropriations Subcommittee on Higher Education, and provided terrific leadership during those years as well. In 84, I left the legislature and went to work at Central Michigan University, and I worked for the provost up there and as an associate vice provost. By the way, that means you do whatever the provost doesn't want to do. And worked there for 6 years. And in 1991, Phil Sorotkin called me. And he said, hey, we're establishing an interstate compact in the Midwest. And he said, it's going to be a little bit like Wichi and NEBE and the Southern Regional Education Board. He said, would you be interested in applying? You really should consider it. And he talked some more, and we had a good exchange and so forth. And I thought, well, maybe I will try to apply. I called Bill Sederburg, and I asked him about it. And he gave me a terrific background statement on all the work that Phil had done, and he had done, and Roger, and the Midwest Legislative Conference, and Mike McCabe, and the Council of State Governments. And I thought, this really sounds like something has a tremendous amount of merit and just makes an awful lot of horse sense. And so I submitted my name and applied. And I remember when they asked questions, Bill said to me later, he said, you know, when you get really serious, your voice starts dropping. He said, you talk softer and softer and softer. And I noticed as we were going through the interview, people started doing this, all the selection committee members. And they're all listening, trying to figure out what the heck I was saying. But when I went to that meeting, I came with the idea. I said, we really need to be a grassroots-based organization Rather than building a central management and control function, we wanted to tap the talents and the resources of colleges and universities and our state governments in our member states and develop creative new programs. And MHEC can support and rally and do the secretarial work, the background work, and so forth, but the mind power for the whole organization should be grassroots based. And that was number one theme. The second thing that I presented at that meeting was that we really should give serious consideration to about four different program initiatives. I said, number one, the Midwest has been lacking student exchange and participation on a regional basis. And it would be very, very helpful to our colleges, to our students, to their families throughout the Midwest, if we had some sort of a Midwest student exchange mechanism to enable students to go across state lines and participate in programs where they had open billets, open availability for students from other states. That was number one program proposal. The number two program proposal was in the area of risk management, loss control, and loss prevention, which was another major problem in higher education at that time. It was virtually impossible for any college or university, or even a college or university system, to write a manuscript insurance policy covering all of the campuses. We had to take SO 9000 policies, and they really didn't address many of the needs of higher education. For example, at the University of Missouri in 1993, I believe it was, they had just hired a research professor from Princeton University to come out on a special $1 million project, a research project with the National Science Foundation. He brought all of his research papers and technology and everything and hauled them out in a van, put them on the loading dock at the university, went to turn the van in, came back. The dump trucks had come during the day. They picked up all of those papers and the whole research project, put it in the dump truck, took it to the trash bins and burned it. And that was a loss of about $700,000 in research papers. We had no coverage for that kind of thing. I can go on and on, all different kinds of incidences like that. So we thought a strong risk management program might be beneficial to our colleges and universities. So we recommended that program as an initiative as well. The next major initiative that we wanted to look into and explore was really twofold. The first was telecommunications, because we were paying, in Kansas, the colleges and universities were paying 22 cents a minute to go long distance on voice, video, and data exchanges. In Michigan, we were paying 7 cents a minute. Some of the other states were paying 10, 12 cents a minute. We thought, in telecommunications, it's largely a question of volume. And if you can go into AT&T or MCI, it existed at that time, or Sprint, and say we want to buy 1 million minutes a month or 1 million minutes a week or whatever, you're going to get a lot more attention and a lot better rates than if you were just trying to leverage 100, 200, 300,000 minutes. So we recommended a telecommunications initiative, and right behind that, we wanted to also develop, almost in tandem with it, a technology equipment initiative, because the industry was changing dramatically. The first desktop computer with the Macintosh had only been around for 6-7 years. It was established in 1984 when the first ones came out. The internet wasn't a reality yet, but it was going to be a reality. And we had an interest in getting representation on the World Wide Web Council for that reason. But telecommunications and technology were major, major issues of the day that had a lot of change associated with them for the next decade or so. So that was the third initiative. The fourth initiative dealt with minority faculty development. We had a problem in Midwest higher education in the 1980s, the late 80s and the 90s, which hit our research universities especially hard, but it also hit our state universities as well and our private universities as well. We were losing minority faculty, senior minority faculty in our colleges and universities to other universities on the East Coast or the West Coast, places like Stanford or Princeton or MIT or whatever. And we were having a real problem retaining minority faculties from all different countries and nationalities and so forth. And we wanted to explore that issue and see if there was anything we could do to promote or encourage the development of minority faculty in the Midwest. And we felt that there was an opportunity to receive substantial funding from the foundations to really examine that issue and to see if there was any role that you could play in the Midwest to try to promote minority faculty development in our colleges and universities. So those were the four initiatives we started with. And they drew straws, and I got the short straw. But stopping here for a second. The first thing that I did as president when I was hired is I asked Phil Sorokin to join me in the endeavor. I remember that conversation well. He said, what do you want me to be? And I said, you can be whatever you want to be. I don't care what title you use. I said, I've got president, but you can have whatever else you want. And he decided he wanted to be senior advisor, and that made a lot of sense to me. And that started a partnership and a close friendship, almost a brotherhood friendship, for the next 11 years. And we remain friends, close friends, until Phil's passage many years later. But that was probably one of the smartest, that was the first and smartest staffing move I made in my whole tenure as president. And together, we built those programs. We didn't go out and hire a lot of staff. I had an administrative assistant secretary, and that was it for the first year or two. I had some help from Jeff Williams, who had interned under Bill at the Michigan legislature, and was in his graduate program at the University of Minnesota, and Jeff came over and helped me get organized. And in fact, the logo wasn't the result of a big committee effort. It was a result of a meeting at about 10 o'clock at night in my office with Jeff and I sitting huddled around the table looking at all of the different symbols of higher education and to see if we could come up with a quick, fast logo that could capture what we were about. And the mortarboard seemed to make a lot of sense. It was simple, it was direct, and everybody knows what a mortarboard is. Advancing education through cooperation, again, was exactly what we wanted to do. We wanted to help advance education through cooperation among the member states. It wasn't a great story with a great profound, it was pretty simple and pretty direct, but it served well for the time. The next thing that we had to decide on after, except for the business of getting the compact up and running, the Articles of Incorporation. We had to file the compact with Washington, D.C. because states aren't allowed to enter into compacts with each other without having congressional authority to do so. So we had to file all of the compact papers with the U.S. Congress to get approval to form the fourth compact, which that all came about. We hired a very, very an excellent law firm in Lynch, Gallagher, Lynch, and Martineau out of Michigan. And reminded me of one of the law firms in a John Grisham novel. They were very small front door, but they represented some very, very large corporations. And they provided superb service and guidance and legal assistance to us on all of those kinds of questions. Finally, how do we develop the programs? And it was really simple and direct. I got on the telephone and I knew pretty well who the business vice presidents and the risk managers were and the telecommunications directors were in Michigan. And I knew who some of the key leaders were of those entities, so those associations and groups. And so I went to the other states and I called the risk managers of the University of Missouri, for example, or Truman State or some of the other colleges in the University of Missouri. I said, when you have an issue, I called the telecommunications director or the risk manager, whoever it might be, when you have an issue, when you have a problem, when you need to talk with somebody who can give you some good salty dog advice, who do you talk to? Who do you go see? And I started compiling a list. And there was always somebody that they would go to, kind of the senior guy or gal who's been the person that their colleagues would turn to in times of special problems and need for advice and counsel. Then I went to those people and I said, look, we have an initiative here that we really want to try to get off the ground, but we want it to be grassroots based. And we, to do that, we've got to capture the mind power and the talent and the expertise of a few really top drawer professionals in this field. And we were wondering if you would be willing to, on behalf of your colleagues and all the colleges and universities in Missouri or Kansas or wherever it was, if you'd be willing to give us your time to meet, to evaluate the development of a program in this area. And every state had that we asked, or individual in those states that we asked, said yes. And from there, we started meeting, and we provided the resources to them. They would explore the program. If they thought it had a lot of merit, they would write a proposal for a program, and I'd take it to the commission. This was all very fast, as a matter of fact. This was turning over in months, not years. And then if the commission approved it, then I'd go back and I'd say, would you be able to serve on the committee to do an RFP and to see if we could find a partner, someone to partner up with to provide these goods and services. And they agreed, every one of them agreed. And so then we would do an RFP and we would interview all the various companies. And then we would enter into a contract agreement with the help of our legal advice. We always had low price guarantee contracts with all of our providers. And we also had 90-day escape clauses with all of our providers with very limits on liability to MEC and to these states. And if the program was approved by the commission for implementation, then that committee would become sort of like a board of directors for that particular program. They would be the group that would watch over it, shepherd it, evaluate it. And if it wasn't doing what we hoped it would do, or if it had fulfilled its purpose, they would be the first to recommend a sunset. And we did sunset a lot of programs. So that's how it came about. And the whole philosophy and the direction, the grassroots participation, seeking out and finding the best and brightest of our colleges, universities, state agencies, and so forth in our 12 Midwestern states was a key hallmark of MEC. And I'm proud to say I think it still is. And that's how it happened. Lana?
Thanks. I did want to make certain we had some time for some questions if you had that. So I'll keep my remarks fairly brief. When I was first elected to the legislature, I thought I would be on the Education Committee because I was a teacher. Well, that didn't work out, but I heard about an initiative and went to my first meeting in 1989 with the Council of State Governments and heard about the notion of the Midwest Higher Education Compact. I represented a community where Kansas State University is, and we also had several church-related schools and independent colleges. So I thought, well, maybe higher education is an area where I would like to focus. And I don't remember there being a huge race between Minnesota and Kansas as to which one would join MEC first. I think it all had to do with being on the calendar, and I actually carried that bill in Kansas and got involved. But I think as I look to some of the strength of the Midwest Higher Education Compact, it's the composition and the talent that's brought forward. Yes, we have legislators. It is a bipartisan effort. If there is a legislator who's a commissioner, there's an alternate who is from the other party. The House and Senate represented, the governor's office many times will bring in private sector commissioners, someone who has that perspective, and I know our incoming chair of MEC is from the private sector through a gubernatorial appointment. We also have people who represent higher education. Some are representing Board of Regents and so on. But in our in our member states, we have different governance structures too. And I think the unifying factor, the unifying piece of advancing an agenda on behalf of higher education institutions, and I'm talking about all higher education institutions, rests with MHEC. 4 or 5 years ago, the word compact made people nervous to have to work with other states and so on. And in some ways, some still look to that. But a recent compact that has gained membership is patterned after the Midwest Higher Education Compact, and that's the Military Children's Compact. I don't know if many of you are Military Families Compact. But again, taking the different branches of government and working together. I wanted to take a few minutes to talk about the cost containment piece, because David mentioned this too, times were skinny and tight, and money was short for higher education. In some of our states, it's being cut again. But being able to look to ways that you can cooperate and still provide services, I think is really important. The student exchange program is one that has saved, at least in Kansas, and I think all of you know your respective places, millions and millions of dollars for taxpayers. Not the bureaucracy, not the institutions themselves, but the people at home that many legislators have represented. The cost-saving programs that we've had through being able to belong to, I'm trying to think of Oracle, the computers, looking at different areas. When that information would come out for the states, they would think, well, our library in our town is saving money. Our clinic across in the next county is saving money. So I think those kinds of things, not only has MHEC been for higher education institutions, but it has direct impact on taxpayers, on students, on families, and the general public. So I want to applaud that effort as MHEC has moved on. I did have an opportunity to serve as a commissioner with three different presidents and then be an interim myself. And I will tell you that the presidents are as strong as the commissioners and the staff. And at this point, the staff at Midwest Higher Education Compact, they are excellent. Rob, how long have you been there?
19?
20 years. Mary?
18.
Yeah, I mean, these guys grew up at MHEC, you know. And all of the staff there is responsive, professional, and constantly on the look for ways to make the Midwest Higher Education Compact even stronger. I'm going to take just a few minutes here to see if there are questions that you might have. And it looks like Larry's on the move, so we'll look to him as well.
Well, I have one. I'd like you to just talk about... when you look back, and now we're here in 2016, have the expectations been met, and what more could we be doing? When you just look at the whole thing, anybody? Where have we really hit, and what more can we be doing?
Well, you can work harder, Larry. That's,
work harder, work okay. Harder.
Certainly, I don't think, well, I shouldn't speak for it, but the group that I was hanging around, I don't think we had any great expectations of what the organization would look like in 25 years. To my point of view, it was fun to be working with a creative group of people that had a mutual interest and to build something positively and to see where it would go. So
keep the creativity there. Yeah,
I think that would be a theme, is to always reinvent yourself and look at the current issues. And, you know, we dealt with those issues, you know, like early on Dave mentioned the virtual private network, and that was significant. Well, that's no longer as significant, clearly, because of the internet connectivity and all the fiber optic and stuff. So A, creativity and building things to make life a little bit better, I think, is what the expectation is. The challenge that I would throw out, some of you that know me know this is a little bit of my current theme, and that is I think that we're moving into this interconnected, internet-based world so dramatically that there needs to be an emphasis of connecting institutions and facilitating the pathways that students go through institutions. Yep. And share credits and certificates of competencies and all of this. And I think there's a huge agenda out there for how do we shift to thinking about applying the internet metaphor to our higher education systems. And so I think that's going to be the next generation of issues, but that certainly wasn't in our thinking in 1990. Our thinking then was, we know there's a need, we know there's a creativity that's gone on, how do we do that in the Midwest?
Well, certainly from my observation, you have exceeded the expectations that I had based upon the accounting that you just heard not long ago. I don't, if this were 25 years ago and you were reflecting on your 25th anniversary, it would not be near as profound. You have to calculate into this equation your success, this technology revolution. You were strategically positioned at exactly the right time, and that has certainly has helped. And I think going along with Bill's comments, you're strategically positioned now as a mature organization to advance that.
Larry, in answer to your question, I sat here and I listened to this meeting. I think the compact has far exceeded my expectations. I'm just overwhelmed with the progress that MHEC has made over the last, 15 years now, or 16 years. And I applaud you. I think it's incredible what you've done. I'd echo what both Roger and Bill said about the future. I think finding ways to continue to work together across lines of policy difference, lines of protocol differences, and find ways to come together and to work together to help all of our states and all of our citizens in all of our states is a very, very worthy cause, and that cause will never end. It's just got to be ongoing. So I congratulate everyone and I applaud you for all of your great work.
I'm reminded of Sarah as well as the military credit, two fairly recent initiatives in the history of MHEC. And again, looking at that reach out of not only the public institutions, but in that case, we're looking at the for-profits, we're looking at the independent as well as public. The military piece, again, I think it shows a way that MHEC can be nimble in focusing on a particular group and then building out from that. So those are two recent initiatives that show that MHEC can respond. They listen to their commissioners. They listen to what needs to be done and then collectively work on it together.
Okay, we've got time for maybe one or two questions. I know we're running behind.
I think one of our overwhelming challenges is student debt, and we've not really addressed that well with that $1.25 trillion debt hanging over our country and over our students. And that brings to mind that we really have to facilitate more business into the educational system. So one of our goals was to prevent duplication and things like that. So that's my overwhelming concern about the future.
Yep. Cost efficiencies and effectiveness of delivery will continue to be big issues, no doubt about it. Mark.
I appreciate the comment about technology. I think that was Roger, you were making that comment. I was just at WICHE Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and big topics were cybersecurity, artificial intelligence, distance education, and I was making exactly the same point that these compacts are incredibly well aligned to the future. You know, a regional identification, the power place still matters where you live, but they are collaborative, they share things, et cetera. It's been compounded now by what's happening in Washington, D.C., meaning the importance of MEC and WICHI, et cetera. And I'm a non-resident fellow at New America, and when I took the job back in North Dakota and left Washington, I thought they would kick me off the New America Foundation, but instead the response surprised me. This is last summer. A woman named Anne Marie Slaughter, who if Mrs. Clinton was elected probably would have been the Secretary of State, she said, you know what, it's great Mark's going back home because Washington is getting so tied in knots. And I don't know if Tim Flackle's here, but she was the keynote speaker, Tim, at your conference last summer. She said something similar. I'm increasingly convinced that America is going to change in the states and in the regions because we just can't make it happen in Washington anymore.
Yeah.
So I just wonder if people can reflect on that, kind of a combination on Roger's idea that, you know, technology is bringing us together in ways that shrink distance, but also with Washington heading to maybe paralysis, it's going to be things like the letter you just drafted today to go out, which he was thinking something similar, that maybe this is a new level of activity by MEC that is going to be imperative going forward. Any thoughts on those? Combining those two theses together for the people who helped build this thing?
Retiring, I live in Asheville, North Carolina currently, and I'm involved in a local leadership group that's done a lot of work in regional development. And went to a conference in Grand Rapids, Michigan a couple of years ago for CEOs for cities. The big takeaway from that group was that, A, you cannot look to Washington to rebuild regions. Their message was you can't look to state governments to rebuild regions. It has to be ground level roots building, and the element of place is becoming the dominant theme. And regional collaborative efforts, often led by universities within those regions. And I think that this is probably going to be the case for the next number of years, and that if we're going to build the kind of communities that we want, the universities are going to have to step up. But on a larger level, how can you build those networks among states and networks among communities? So. Anyway, that's how it's impacted me most recently. And so as we looked at this in Asheville, North Carolina, the issue is how can Asheville, North Carolina, achieve things by their own efforts and not going to Washington or the state government, but what can we do locally? And that's a whole other presentation. But it's to your point, I think, that...
You're adding a third thing. Universities are crucial to that future.
If you look at the, in my opinion, if you look at the successful, however you define successful, community of the future, or region, not just city, but region of the future, it's fiber optic cabling and gigabit service. It's a strong higher education, workforce development network within that. And Randy, listen to this, Furlicker and I go back a number of years, a very strong entrepreneurial hospitality and funding system for those regions. And so in our area of Asheville, we're taking that seriously. We have a task force on gigabit service and a very interesting model called Next Generation Network. We are doing things trying to get the universities to step up in a regional vision profile for what's needed in the region. And then the entrepreneurship, just in the last couple of years, creating venture capital groups and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And where MEC now, since those MEC can come in, is that a lot of that networking and building upon that asset-based management strategies, I think, is what MEC has done so well over the years. I think to zero in on those issues of the future and apply that model could be a very interesting agenda item for MEC.
Yeah.